Good afternoon or good day for wherever you are. My name is Andrew Gilmore and I'm the Executive Director of the Berghoff Foundation. We are currently celebrating our 50th anniversary and which we are celebrating through a series of special events. And last month, we at Berghoff, together with U4 Anti-Corruption Resource Center, published a paper entitled The Vicious Cycle, entry points for anti-corruption in inclusive peace processes. Now, earlier this year, we had adopted this issue as one of our strategic priorities, something we really want to look into in more detail and with greater depth over the next few years. Because what we find is that the unequal distribution of resources is really quite often a key source of violent conflict, and as we've witnessed that in many parts of the world. And so those working on conflict transformation need to do a lot more in partnership with others to address this challenge. So we are absolutely committed to advancing this conversation, especially with the anti-corruption community and organizations such as U4. And this event, which I think will explain a little bit the context and the key recommendations of the paper, is very much a first step in this regard. So thank you very much indeed for joining us today, and I hand the floor to our moderator.
Thank you very much to our Executive Director, Andrew Gilmore, for his welcoming remarks, which really set the tone for today's event. I want to wish you all a very warm welcome to a rather overcast Berlin. My name is Callum Humphreys. I'm a junior project manager here at the Berghoff Foundation in the Yemen unit, and I'm a contributing author of the paper that we will be discussing today. It's really a pleasure to moderate today's event. As Andrew has already mentioned, the paper that we will be discussing today is entitled Breaking the Vicious Cycle: Entry Points for Anti-Corruption in Inclusive Peace Processes. The paper's lead author is Dr. Ulrike Hopp-Neschenke, and my fellow contributing author is Dr. Joshua Rogers, both of whom will be joining us today to discuss how anti-corruption can be integrated into peace processes. They will also be joined on the panel by Dr. Christine Cheng and Dr. David Jackson, the paper's editor. The paper, which was published just a couple of weeks ago, is the result of a collaboration between the Berghoff Foundation and U4 Anti-Corruption Resource Center, and is available to read right now via the link posted in the chat. So when we finish here today, I would very much encourage you to take a look at the paper in both long and short form. So just a little bit of context on the paper, drawing on interviews with mediation practitioners, as well as both the conflict transformation and anti-corruption literatures, this paper considers how corruption as an element of conflict systems could be addressed during peace processes, and how peace builders can support political efforts to curb corruption and promote accountability during transitions from war to peace. We argue that now is the time to bridge the contributions of peace building and anti-corruption practitioners in the quest for a sustainable, transformative process. So just a couple of points before we kick off the discussion today. We'll have a couple of rounds of questions to each of the panelists. There will be an opportunity at the end for a 10 to 15 minute Q&A from the audience. However, we only have an hour and time is pushing on, so we may not get round to all of your questions, but please ask them throughout using the Q&A function, where the raise hand function is not working today. And I'll try and pose as many as possible to our panelists. And to the panelists, I would encourage you all to come in on each other's points where possible, so we have a more open discussion. So without further ado, let's get into it. Our first panelist is Dr. David Jackson. He is a senior advisor at the U4 Anti-Corruption Resource Center and the editor of this paper. As with all of today's panelists, a longer bio for David can be found in the chat. So turning to you, David, for the first question. Why is it important to discuss the relationship between peace building and anti-corruption today, i.e. right now, and to launch this paper at this particular juncture?
That's a good question, Callum. Thank you. Thank you for that. Good, if quite difficult question to answer, but I will do my best. So hello to everyone. I'm really glad to be here. So yes, so why corruption? Why corruption and not other really important issues within peace building, like economic development or human rights or gender relations or food supply or even climate issues? So why should peace builders take corruption more seriously? And I think the first reason is because we as organizations think they should. And I think during both of our organizations' work at U4 and at Berghof, I think we've sensed that there is this gap. So at U4, we do a lot of work in sectors, in education, in justice sector, in climate change, for example, but we felt actually peace building, there's a bit of a gap there. And I think Berghof also felt the same. So I think we feel it's incumbent upon us to push this issue forward. But I think much more importantly is that there is a growing body of evidence that I think makes things very clear that we cannot really look away, that we cannot really deprioritize this issue. And it's quite interesting if we look back at anti-corruption and peace building, because of course this is not the first time that anti-corruption has been discussed in the context of peace building, but what we see is a bit of a rise and fall. So I think perhaps most recently there was a lot of debates when interventions were going on in the Western Balkans on the role of corruption and post-conflict state building and peace processes in particular. And I think what emerged was a recognition that this was a really difficult policy area, that there's no hard and fast rules about the role corruption plays in peace processes. On the one hand, we know it undermines peace and prospects for peace. On the other, we know, well, corruption may be stabilizing at certain points. And perhaps it was this ambivalence that meant it was really hard to establish firm kind of policy approaches. And then I think much more recently, evidence from Afghanistan in particular, but also places like Iraq, even Lebanon, has demonstrated just how damaging corruption can be. And especially if corruption is allowed to become endemic. We know that massive amounts of aid, for example, committed to peace were manipulated, squandered, and stolen. So in a way it's become, the evidence has suggested it's really difficult to continue this kind of ambivalence and has forced us to be a bit braver. We know it's complex. We know it's a really difficult challenge to confront corruption, but we need to be a bit braver. And I think just the final reason is that it's certainly come on the radar of key actors. So both bilateral development agencies and international organizations. So they are certainly taking an interest in this. And this is helping, I think, to push the agenda forward.
Fantastic. Thank you for tackling the hard ball early on, David. So now I will turn to the paper's lead author, Dr. Ulrika Hopner-Schenker, who is currently deputy head of the Afghanistan, Pakistan and Central Asia Division at Germany's Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development, BMZ. Ulrika, what the paper is entitled is Breaking the Vicious Cycle, Entry Points for Anti-Corruption in Inclusive Peace Processes. So can you possibly sketch out a little bit, what are the dimensions of this vicious cycle mentioned in the title?
Yeah, of course. Thank you, Willem. Thank you for having us. It's indeed important to consider both phenomena, that of violent conflict and that of corruption, as interconnected and mutually reinforcing, thus creating a system of conflict blatant corruption. And Burkhoff, of course, has been working a lot on understanding violent conflict as a system, but we really want to bring in corruption as well and explore in this report how both reinforce each other. We argue that we can only support peace processes when at the same time addressing corruption beyond mere compliance measures that we implement in any kind of project or activity, usually in the aid industry. But before I get started on talking about the vicious circle, we need to understand that corruption isn't only an arbitrary, reckless behavior of individuals who are abusing power for their own good, as most people would think of fraud or theft or pilfering. In addition, in many fragile and conflict-affected contexts, it has a deeper dimension, thus significantly defining how those societies work. It's important to look at social norms around corruption. A big nod here goes to our colleagues at the Corruption, Justice and Law program of Fletcher School, who are working tirelessly on systemic understanding of corruption and as well as social norms. We share with them the understanding of this vicious circle that has two sides, really. Corruption is a root cause and a driver for violent conflict, and it's contributing to fragility since it affects state legitimacy, authority, and capacity. It increases insecurity by affecting accountability and rule of law. It enables and escalates violent conflict, creating grievances and impunity, and it reduces trust in the state and affects thus social contracts and social cohesion. And on the other hand, violent conflict enables corruption as well by reallocating political and also military power from legitimate state actors to non-state actors, thus undermining the state's monopoly on violence and political participation. It weakens formal institutions and public administrations, undermining the provision of public service and delegitimizing the rule of law. It also strengthens the economic rule, by strengthening informal black markets or enabling illicit border trade and trafficking, thus undermining efforts towards a formal market economy and a peace dividend that we aim for in a peace process, and by triggering the influx of external resources for humanitarian assistance in crisis or peace building or post-conflict development assistance, thus actually creating new opportunities for rent seeking. So you can all easily think of examples how these aspects reinforce each other, creating a vicious circle. And we argue that we need to address this in a more integrated way, overcoming the silos between governance and anti-corruption and peace building. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ulrike. So it seems like this topic is too pressing to ignore, but then people invested in the paper would say that. We're now turning to Dr. Christine Cheng, who's a lecturer in war studies at King's College London, specializing in conflict economies, peace building and corruption, and somebody who, for the purposes of this session, is acting as a bit of a sounding board for some of the findings in the paper. I hope it's a role that you take on willingly, Christine. So I would ask you then, as somebody who's been considering the interlinkages between peace building and corruption for many years, what do you see as the key trade-offs and dilemmas for peace builders who are attempting to work both in and on corruption?
So thanks for the question, Callum, and thank you all for having me participate in today's discussion. So first thing I want to say is I'm really grateful that for the work that's been done on this, because I feel like I've been shouting in the dark about this for such a long time, and it just hasn't gotten the attention that it deserves. And I'm super grateful that all of you have actually put in all of this work to say exactly this. It's an area that just deserves so much more attention, because it is the enabling platform for so many more things that happen within those societies. So thank you, first of all, for doing this work. And then to the question itself about those key trade-offs and dilemmas. So I want to go back to, I think, part of what David was saying at the start around stabilization, right? So from the peace building side of things, people who think about mediating conflicts, trying to bring together a peace agreement, their core concern is putting an end to the violence. That's the first and foremost thing that they're thinking about. How do we get people to the table? How do you get the government to the table? And how do you get rebel actors, terrorist groups, whoever it is that you want to the table, to the table? And the difficulty with doing that is one of the ways in which you can get people to a settlement is to offer them something, right? So you control this bit of territory in exchange for bringing in all the violence to an end. We will let you control this ministry or this set of resources, or we will give you something, right? Some form of patronage or power that you get to sustain. And then we all go on and we share power in a way, right? So we have to also start from the assumption that the states that we're often talking about are not as well governed or as well run and are often corrupt from the government side, right? So there's that dynamic of it. And then the question is, well, then who do you bring to the table to share some of the spoils of that, right? What kind of peace dividend are you going to give the people that hold arms and get them to the table? As soon as you push too hard on the corruption side, on the anti-corruption side, you remove one of the tools from the negotiating package, right? So I think that's the core difficulty. That doesn't preclude, though, what Ulrika was saying, and what this paper is saying, is that you need to bear all of that in mind, and that you're trading off a bunch of short-term considerations for a long-term, some kind of long-term payoff, right? So if you're calibrating this really, really well, you push it to the ultimate brink where everybody says, okay, I'm really just about to walk away from the table. You don't give me any more and I'm going to leave, right? So you want to bring an end to the violence, but you need to cede as little of that anti-corruption territory as possible while still bringing people to the table. And then over time, I think the trick is you need to then slowly, slowly draw it all back and make that peace much more inclusive. And that's just a really hard balance to strike, because as soon as you take away power and, you know, frankly, money or influence from a group that has it and controls it, they're not going to want to give that up, and they're not going to give it up easily. So that's the political magic that has to take place. And that's a core message of the work that's being done here, right? Which is, this is not a technical issue. This is fundamentally a political issue. And I want to draw your attention to this line on the second page of the report, right? Reducing corruption, like building peace, is a long-term political context during which setbacks are frequent and successes are hard fought and uncertain. And that term, you know, long-term political contest, that's the key, right? If we think about both of those things as long-term political contests, that's the right way, I would say, to frame a lot of what is going on here. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Christine. And maybe picking up where you've left off with the question for the final, last but not least, panelist, my colleague in the Yemen unit here at the Berghoff Foundation, Dr. Joshua Rogers, who's a senior project manager and advisor here at Berghoff. He's also a contributing author to this paper. So what Christine was saying about striking this balance between between corruption and conflict, and also this long-term political contest, I mean, how does it help to think about these things with a systemic approach to tackling corruption and conflict? This is what the paper strongly advocates for, but what does this exactly look like and how can it be best pursued?
Thanks very much, Callum, and thanks for having me and to everyone else. I mean, I think Ulrika already really started to unpack this a little bit in terms of talking about the vicious cycle between conflict and corruption and the need to think about it in an integrated way. So I think, you know, in some ways it's sort of taking a systemic approach is a slightly fancy way of saying that, right? But it means thinking about conflict and corruption in terms of a system where the parts are connected. And so in the first instance, it's a tool of analysis to try to analyze and visualize complexity and to identify vicious cycles, but also virtuous cycles, right? How do things reinforce each other, but also where are dynamics, where there are potential entry points where conflict might decrease as a result. So You know, I guess a little bit more concretely, it means thinking about how forms of economic marginalization, for example, how abuse of power can act as conflict drivers, and similarly, how dynamics associated with conflict, right? Often we see a shortening of time horizons. There's more legitimacy to using violence, weakening and calling into question of peacetime sort of due process and controls, checks and balances. I mean, to some extent, we're witnessing a very mediated and weakened form, but just, you know, right now in Germany, in the discussion around military aid, because suddenly, you know, all of these violence looms so much larger. So, you know, I think it's about thinking about these systemic connections, and so then building on that, it can help identify, well, what are the most destabilizing forms of corruption. I mean, as Christine has said, it's not a matter of and also Ulrika highlighted this, right? It's not a matter of trying to stamp out kind of fraud or petty bribes or whatever. It's about thinking strategically in terms of the peace process, what forms of corruption are really a long-term hindrance to the consolidation of peace, and then trying to approach these difficult trade-offs that Christine has outlined, right? So at what point what deals are you kind of willing to accept and which ones are off balance? And we don't have answers to that, but we are advocating very forcefully that these are discussions that need to be had, and it's a strategic kind of trade-off that needs to be considered very carefully.
Thank you very much, Joshua, completing the first round of questions in which we're thinking about the context of the paper and why now, and giving some examples about what it's about. Before we move on to the next round, which is a bit more forward looking and what Joshua has mentioned, moving from this vicious cycle to a more virtuous cycle, I just want to remind everybody that you can ask questions via the Q&A function. I don't have to be the only one formulating questions today, and we would very much invite them there. So please go ahead and do that. So shifting on now to the second round of questions, and once again, I'd encourage panelists to come in on each other's points where they can. Picking it up again with Ulrika, and what I want to ask you is, given the sensitivities surrounding this topic in the peace building community, what are a couple of simple entry points for practitioners working in corruption? And when we say working in corruption, we have these three different distinctions in the paper: working around, working in, and working on. So maybe you can give us a little bit of context as to what those mean as you answer this question.
Yeah, great. Thanks for bringing this up and asking about now practical entry points, because this sounds all a bit heady, right? And sort of very analytical, but what do we do now? And we have adapted this quite well-known distinction regarding aid responses to conflict that was developed many years ago, of working around conflict, working in and on. And I'll be speaking about a little bit what it means to work in corruption and conflict together. As we said, it has to be interconnected. We have to look at it as an interconnected phenomenon, meaning that agencies recognize the need to be more sensitive to both corruption and conflict dynamics together and adapt policies and programs accordingly, instead of avoiding the issue of corruption and just working on peace building and treating corruption as a negative externality, following simply compliance rules and leaving the rest to the governance crowd, right? So looking at working in corruption and conflict, what should we do differently? First of all, peace and conflict analysis and peace building strategies should address political economy, power, and corruption more deliberately. this is true for both communities, anti-corruption and peace-building practitioners, that a further integration of each other's analytical approaches could really prove helpful, we find. It's hardly realized in practice. So each of them does their own context analysis, but we should really explore how to use them in a more integrated way. For example, political economy and power analysis in peace process could be really helpful to help identify power and resource allocations that hinder peace processes and or lead to a stalemate, because, you know, as Christine was pointing out, people are losing potentially, or they have something to gain, and thus facilitate transformation. At the same time, an integration of political economy analysis with an assessment of peace building needs, which is often done by peace builders, helps to understand entry points for peace support that can offer a new perspective also for prioritizing anti-corruption interventions, because it will point to their significance for the peace process. In literature, and Christine has written a lot about this, there is quite a discussion on stabilizing and destabilizing effects of corruption. And it would be really interesting to see how this, and if this can really actually be used when developing and prioritizing anti-corruption strategies in the context of a peace process. Secondly, building on the well-established concept of conflict sensitivity that you all probably know, we argue that do no harm can be enriched towards an integrated approach. What do we mean here? That means to fully understand this context of corruption and conflict and the political economy in which we're operating. And by doing so, we can appreciate how our own actions interact with a system of conflict and corruption and reduce destructive impact, as well as aim for positive impact on both corruption and conflict. This might often be a trade-off, mind you. But we feel it's really better to have a chance to take a conscious decision and weighing these trade-offs that we have in policy decisions than not being aware at all of the unintended impact that we have when choosing one option over the other. This is particularly true when aiming for stabilization measures, where there's more transformative approaches or opting to bring in certain stakeholders that you need for peace process, but which are considered, for example, as corrupt and illegitimate by society. What does that mean later on for process? What does that mean for accountability? Vice versa. One particular aspect here is also public expectations that are really important, both for conflict transformation and increasing transparency and accountability. If we, for example, with anti-corruption programs, fail to meet unrealistic reform expectations that may lead to public disappointment and deepen social and political distrust, we have done each other a disservice, right? And thirdly, and there's much more to say about this, we should really encourage principled approaches towards accountability and integrity within all kinds of peace-building interventions. This starts with breaking taboos. Often corruption risks in peace building and peace support work are a taboo and excluded from peer learning initiatives and activities. So we need to create a safe space for such conversations, because many peace builders told us that questions of how to address corruption risks bother them, but they are not sure how to really bring them up. And it's not really spoken about. While we do all other kinds of exchanges, we don't talk about this. One example for such safe spaces that could be useful, for example, to address expectations of sugarcoating and incentivize participation, for example, in dialogue events. As you know, in some approaches of peace support work, the participation of all stakeholders is really required in order for the intervention to succeed. In such context, participation is often incentivized to make sure that participants can attend and are compensated for their time. But where does the real sugarcoating start? Now, the Arusha peace talks, for example, are known for having led to a whole village of bungalows that were built by the participants, because they actually make quite a bit of money out of being participants. Sitting allowances are obviously not leading to that effect, but are another point in case. Often there are expected benefits for kin and social networks to find employment, or have some other benefit if stakeholders are engaged and trusted participants in peace activities. And it's really important for peacemakers to address these expectations and find a way to be accountable towards them in order to avoid tarnishing peace processes. And maybe last point we can take this to the discussion is we should really enhance downward accountability towards beneficiaries more. That means emphasizing the relevance of transparency and accountability, not upward towards donors only, but rather downward to those who the interventions, of course, affect. And thus allowing local actors to take ownership in the peace process. And I'll speak to that later more. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ulrike. And it's really important, as you've emphasized, to give some practical steps to advance the conversation and for both communities of practice to really mull over and consider together, because it's not an exposition of the answers here, but it's really the bare bones of pushing the conversation forward. So thanks for giving an overview of entry points of working in corruption. Moving to Joshua now, and keeping with the theme of these entry points, where do you see those entry points being in peace processes for working on corruption? And probably just give, if possible, a little distinction between this working in and working on in this context.
Yeah, thanks very much, Callum. I mean, I think the distinction is really, you know, as Ulrike was saying, working in corruption means being very conscious that you're active in a context that is in part marked by corruption, where that's an important dynamic to take into account, where that needs to, as Ulrike has outlined, be part of the analysis, be part of you know, how things are approached. It's not just sort of a risk factor, but it's, you know, sort of fundamentally part of the system to bring up this, you know, systems approach kind of that you're operating in, and by ignoring it, you're not going to get the outcomes that you want. So moving to working on corruption, that's about actually trying to tackle it head on, and making specifically corruption a topic in peace processes, right? In this context, and so I think the paper tries to suggest, and it's really, you know, I think early days, it's really about suggesting entry points. It's food for thought and the beginning of a conversation. So these aren't quite sort of recommendations, but it does this along the sort of three tracks of mediation that are conventionally used and that Liderac introduced. So you have track one, which is the sort of formal high level political level. Track two, which is some of the same people but in their personal capacities, kind of more informal discussions, perhaps also kind of regional leaders, etc. And then track three, which is more of a grassroots level. And in the paper, we try to identify sort of potential entry points for work on all of those, on all three tracks. And I, you know, I really can't go into too much detail, so I encourage you to look at the paper, but maybe just to pick up an example or two on each of these tracks. So at track one level, I think the one of the big takeaways from the paper for us was to say, you know, we need to get away from, really reconsider this kind of peace first, stabilization first approach that Christine mentioned. You know, it's very understandable, right? There's a value in reducing the level of violence. It's not, you know, as has been emphasized a couple of times, it's about a gradual approach and kind of rethinking some of the priorities, not radically reversing them, right? We're not saying anti-corruption first, and if it, you know, takes much longer to resolve the conflict, that's not the idea, but this kind of radical prioritization of peace at the expense of sort of any deal is something that really I think the paper identifies as quite problematic. And so if you work in corruption intelligently, right, if you use these analysis tools that Ulrike has outlined a little bit, you know, that can help start to move to these really difficult conversations, as Christine highlighted, right? They're trade-offs. Okay, well, you know, and it's, you know, a mediator also has a limited role, right? It's also for what the parties are willing to accept, but the people around the peace process can help also them understand the choices they're making and to make sure everyone who needs to be part of the conversation is included. So, right, part of this reevaluation of sort of just a peace first approach, I think, is simply insisting on inclusivity, which I think is recognized that this is key to making peace processes more robust. And there's, you know, there's lots of people who want to put anti-corruption on the agenda. It's not a technical niche subject, but it's a sort of fundamental issue of social justice. It's often a big conflict driver. So simply allowing the space for this to be put on the agenda, I think, is already an important step. I'm conscious of time, so just one kind of more something a little bit more maybe like a recommendation and something more practical is that we see value in thinking about integrating more anti-corruption expertise and peace and mediation support teams, right, to allow this kind of more systematic reflection and also to highlight to parties what implications might be, what options can look like, etc. On the track two level, one of the things that we suggest is the value of encouraging alliances and connections and the risk of organizations that are think of themselves as being primarily peace builders of saying, well, that's an anti-corruption matter, this is a peace matter, and those are often artificial distinctions. So to think instead integratively and about brokering connections and working together and building alliances, I think is another key takeaway. And finally, at the track three level, one of the suggestions is again, it's about overcoming in a somewhat artificial distinction maybe between civic and peace education as tools of shaping social norms around corruption, around violence, as a kind of package, but also to encourage kind of joint reflection and learning at all levels. I mean, Ulrike was stressing the value of that kind of for organizations engaged in this line of work, but of course it's also a value for movements and activists and others who are partners in those processes.
Thank you very much, Joshua, for that very rich answer. And just to pick up on one of the points that you raised in terms of sequencing, because somebody has been asking about it in the chat, and I wanted to kind of raise it to David when asking him, where do we see as the anti-corruption community representative here today? I mean, what do you see as the role of anti-corruption actors here in strengthening this integrated approach that we're speaking about today? And maybe if you could reference where this theme of sequencing and when Joshua is saying peace first and then everything else later, I mean, what's the anti-corruption perspective on that?
Thank you, Callum. Yeah, well, I would suggest, and I think the paper tries to make quite clear that this sequencing hasn't really worked and is fraught with actually dangers. And I think this is what I really like about the paper. It's not a wish list. We're not coming from the anti-corruption community saying, implement these. What we are doing is saying we recognize the dilemmas that peace builders face. And of course, these are legitimate and these are these happen in the real world. So what we are coming with is quite a thoughtful and sensitive approach. We're not offering solutions or grand plans, but a way to navigate a little bit these trade-offs. So we would argue that, we have to end this kind of binary conception peace building, then anti-corruption governance, state building. Let's try and introduce peace building as early as possible, anti-corruption into peace building as early as possible. There are trade-offs, so we need to be careful, but these are practical entry points. And I think that's the real value of the paper, that it really takes into account some of the dilemmas that peace builders face. The paper also makes clear that actually the ball is a little bit now in the anti-corruption court, because as Ulrika mentioned, you know, corruption in these contexts is complex and maybe qualitatively different from corruption we find in other places, in places which aren't fraught with violence or conflict. So in a way, the onus now is a little bit on the anti-corruption community to think through, well, how should we adapt, and how can we adapt and develop some of the tools we have so they work in these contexts? Unfortunately, we didn't have the space to do that in this paper, but I think the paper really lays that challenge, which is nice to have this kind of game of table tennis or tennis. But still, I think anti-corruption practitioners have things to offer. I mean, we are quite a diverse group. I cannot claim that I can represent them all, but you know, I think technical skills are important here. So for example, you know, things like building a procurement system that prevents leaks and prevents, you know, public resources flowing into the bad cycle of corruption and violence. You know, these are very technical matters and require kind of expertise in these areas. Of course, you know, there are lawyers also in the anti-corruption world who think about how to structure accountability and checks and balance. So these are also important skills. And I would also say, you know, anthropologists in anti-corruption who get to grips with some of the norms and discourses around corruption is really important to understand the context of corruption, or how corruption fits in a certain context. And then I think there's the political analysis of corruption, I think, has come a long way in the past decade or so. A lot of it around this notion of political settlements and the role corruption plays in political settlements. And I know this is also increasingly part of the analytical toolkit in peace building. But I think the political analysis around corruption also, I think, is something that can be offered. But I'm also interested in rather than what divides us, what unites us. And I think there are some really interesting commonalities. I think both are interested peace building, anti-corruption, in are shifting collective forms of behavior and the kind of overcoming collective action problems. Also, you know, this systemic perspective, you know, corruption also has to be reckoned with as a systemic problem. And I think both ultimately, as the paper mentions, are about social justice and also understanding that what we see as outcomes don't necessarily emerge by focusing on just on formal institutions, but we need to understand the informality of things. So I think anti-corruption has some things to offer, but I think we also should emphasize, yes, what unites us too.
Thanks very much, David. And I think there will be a few sighs in the virtual room when you say the next stage in this discussion is really in the court of the anti-corruption community. Just on that note, the question that I would pose to, and my last to Christine, would be, you know, when thinking about how this collaboration moves forward, what do you see as the challenges or bumps in the road when uniting these two communities, one on the one hand peace building and on the other hand anti-corruption? And just alluding to a question that we've had come in also, I mean, how can we make this collaboration and conversation stick, you know, not over the next weeks and months, but the years to come?
And I hope it does stick. I think one helpful frame here is to think of the peacebuilding community as short-term incentivized, right? And I'm really thinking about mediators here and the folks that are trying to get people to an agreement. Whereas I think anti-corruption folks and that community is more long-term incentivized in the space of the context of, you know, this particular discussion, right? So short-term versus long-term. And that's a helpful way of thinking about how to align the two groups' incentives and how to get both those communities moving in the same direction. And I want to go back to something, you know, this taboo exists across both of those communities. And a lot of that is the donors, right? So the donors are scared of talking about this. But why are the donors scared of talking about this? It's because it's a political difficulty for the ministers who find it a political difficulty with their publics, right? So all of this goes back to, in part, you have to be able to accept that there's going to be a degree of imperfection in your governance when you're doing stuff overseas, especially when we're talking about states with very little capacity. And just the ability for, say, you know, any government in the UK to deal with a Daily Mail front page that says your taxpayer dollars are your taxpayer pounds are going to funding some corrupt government overseas, and this is your money hard at work, and people get really angry about that. And then that undermines the political considerations for how you do stuff in the future, for humanitarian aid, for basically all of your development programs. So people just shy away from that. So this is basically a difficulty for both of these communities to tackle together, right? So that's something that I think absolutely unites both groups. But thinking in terms of the specific challenges for both of these. So there are a few things here that are brought up in the paper that I think are very helpful. And three things I want to say just very specifically around local ownership, integrity, and then these good enough approaches that are mentioned. And I suggest that everybody, if you don't read anything about this in this paper, read section three, right? That's where the practical stuff comes in. So read section three, because that stuff is gold if you are working on either of in either of these communities. But the difficulty is that, you know, the anti-corruption side is good at some bits and the peace-building side is better at some bits, right? So on the local ownership side, I would say there'd be more discussions in the peace-building side about local ownership and thinking about taking local ownership seriously. And just trying to have that conversation in a more robust way. I don't think that the corruption side has had that discussion at all, but I might be wrong about that. I just don't think that it's there in the same way as it is for the peace building side. So I would say to the anti-corruption folks, take that conversation much more seriously. On the second point around integrity, right? I think that the corruption side has taken that a lot more seriously, right? Thinking about positive role models for behavior is something that I think the anti-corruption discussion hasn't done perfectly, but it's done, at least it started to do. And I don't think the peace building side has done as well. So peace building folks, take that side more seriously and learn from the anti-corruption folks. And then on the good enough approaches, right? Basically, this is talking about, and something I remember talking to Ulrika about, very frustrating for me, that all corruption is not created equal. And that some corruption actually has deliberately social redistributive effects, but it doesn't mean that there's not still some corruption going on there, right? So you can, you know, take $10 or 10 pounds and give away 9 pounds of that and keep 1 pound for yourself. That is still corruption. Or you can keep all 9 pounds and then give away 1 pound. That is also corruption, but they are not viewed the same way. And I think neither community on the peace building side or on the anti-corruption side has thought about those differentiations, right? And this helpful, good enough approaches way of dealing with it is so much more practical. It just speaks to the reality of how things actually work. And I think just being frank about that is probably one of the greatest things that this paper is going to achieve. It's going to open up, I hope, a conversation with donors that says, look, you know, this is what's actually going on the ground. Let's reflect the reality in our programming. And I think that's the thing that people are most scared to do because of all of those political things that I was talking about at the start of this comment. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Christine, for sketching out the parameters of what hopefully is an ongoing collaboration between these two communities. Conscious of the time here, just want to get in a couple of questions from the audience. I think I'll group two together and see where we get to. So the first one I have is from Janathikra, and she is mentioning the context in Sri Lanka and wanted to know what kind of specific types of corruption was seen there that hindered peace processes, and what kind of references what Joshua was saying earlier about the importance of social norms and cultural elements in these different contexts. And then we have one from Anna, who is talking about how can one tackle corruption when dealing with thoroughly corrupt and autocratic governments, especially when one is aware that not only basic values are divergent and different, but key stakeholders have multiple agendas. So two kind of complementary questions on the importance of social norms and the divergence of basic values. Please come in and pick those up. Maybe since Sri Lanka was mentioned, Ulrika, you might want to come in.
Yeah, always. I love to. Janitrika, I mean, I think what's happening just right now, for those who are not following, they're quite huge protests, which hasn't been seen in Sri Lanka for a long time. And it goes back to showing that actually the peace process didn't address some of the really underlying issues of political economy and power allocation in what is a deeply entrenched elite feudalist system, right? How power and resources are allocated in a society, and framing a political process and peace process time and again as only or mostly an ethnopolitical conflict, neglecting socioeconomic dynamics and neglecting dynamics of marginalization, exclusion in society, and thus playing to, you were asking about those corrupt elites that were pilfering the state and the country and society for decades, taking turns ruling the country. This is a perfect example of where you can see time and again that unrest and conflict comes up in different forms, in different forms of grievances and exclusion from different minority groups, and not only minority, but remember also uprisings from the majority ethnic groups, and disenfranchised groups of society that are unsatisfied with this. And this shows how actually conflict transformation has been looked at as a much more complex aspect, and looking at resource and power allocation. And this is exactly what we are talking about. It's not about bribery in a project, really. I mean, our fixation, and this is me, I've been lead author and then on leave from BMZ, but now being back as a donor, our fixation with compliance and zero tolerance in projects, it's all great. We have to do it, Christine said, for project management and taxpayers' money, of course, but it deviates attention from the much deeper and much more important issues of how power is allocated and reallocated with external interventions, and how rent-seeking plays into these dynamics of reallocating power and resources in the way of elites that and stakeholders that want to take advantage of the system. And so that's why I always felt it's frustrating if then in authoritarian context or context of conflict or where the state is part of the conflict, we are resorting to saying, oh, let's just give, capacity building to civil society actors so that they can address corruption, because we can't work with the power holders on this. That's simply not enough. We have to think about different ways to increase accountability, and a good way of doing that is also starting with ourselves and making ourselves more accountable towards people on the ground. This is terribly difficult for donors very often, because we, not the least, also don't want to be sometimes transparent towards regimes that might instrumentalize resources. So there are all kinds of issues of confidentiality and also concerns about protection of actors sometimes that lead us to saying we can't be transparent about aid allocations to a certain degree, but still that also makes aid as a whole a black box and leads time and again, Yemen is another example, to the issue that people are really demanding and asking, so where does this money go that comes in as humanitarian assistance or as aid in a conflict context? And there is, it creates a huge amount of distrust and delegitimization of actors on the ground, be it the state or other actors. And we have to address that. So handing over to the others for more. Thank you.
Yeah, if we could squeeze one last question in, and you can also pick up this divergent agendas question from earlier if you want, but maybe David wants to come in on this one from Kristen asking, is the expertise of anti-corruption activists for the countries where peace building interventions occurred relevant for this effort? She's of the understanding that so far that this needs to be externally driven. We have just a couple of minutes, David.
Extremely important. And yes, I'm sorry, Christine, that we have this impression, or you have this impression that it needs to be externally driven. No, it actually needs to be locally driven. And Christina mentioned about local ownership. I would agree that we haven't got so far on what it means for anti-corruption, but I think this principle of locally driven anti-corruption as a more effective path, I think, is now established, even if we don't quite know what this means. So anti-corruption expertise of activists who know the context, who have the networks, who understand the history, etc., are very relevant. And in fact, external organizations can support and maybe facilitate this process, but ultimately it should be locally driven.
That's a perfect note to end on, really emphasizing the importance of local perspectives to this work and especially to this paper. So we've just hit the hour here in Berlin. Apologies for not squeezing in a couple more questions, but an hour is really quite tight when we've got a paper with such complexity to discuss. So I would just wrap up by saying thanks to all our panelists today, Dr. Ulrike Hopnischanke, Dr. Joshua Rogers, Dr. Christine Cheng, and of course, Dr. David Jackson, for all your answers to the questions. Thanks also goes to Andrew Gilmore for kicking us off today, and to our planning team here at the Berghoff Foundation, without whom this event would not be possible. And last but not least, of course, to the audience for your attention and for your participation and great questions. So I would like to once again encourage you to give our paper a read, Breaking the Vicious Cycle, Entry Points for Anti-Corruption in Inclusive Peace Processes. You can find the link in the chat. There's also a blog post and a short version, so there's really no excuse. And of course, we would very much appreciate your feedback. As Andrew mentioned straight at the top, this is one of our strategic priorities here at Berghoff. So the conversation really does continue. So watch this space for more publications, events, and initiatives on this very topic. So lastly, if you've enjoyed today's event, I would very much encourage you to sign up to the Berghoff Foundation's newsletter to keep involved with this conversation. So thank you very much, everybody, once again, and I wish you a great rest of your day. Goodbye.